Good morning, everyone. So one of the preparatory hymns that Amanda was playing was Open Up Our Eyes. And what is it that we want to open up our eyes for? What is it that we want to see? In the 119th Psalm, in the 18th verse, it says, "Open now mine eyes, and I may behold wondrous things out of thy law." The scriptures in the Bible contain wonderful truths about life. But by far, the most wonderful thing contained in the Bible is God's love for us. We can see God's love in the blessings that he gives us, from the beauty of the world to the people in our lives. God is constantly giving us gifts, large and small, because he loves us. We often experience God's love through our interactions with other people. In the first book of John, in the fourth chapter, verses 9 and 10, it says, "This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son in the world that he might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." That's the biggest show of love that we can possibly get. Do you know that nothing can separate you from the love of God? There are several ways God shows his love to us, and neither our past nor present can separate us from his love. The love of God is unlimited because there is no stop button to his love. He loves us unconditionally, and this is why he sent his only begotten Son to die for our sins, and whosoever believes in him shall not die but have everlasting life. We're destined to be doomed forever, but the love of God in Jesus gave us eternal life. Nobody on earth can love us the way that our Heavenly Father does. There will be times people, especially those we rely on the most, will disappoint us, and this makes us question their love. But our Heavenly Father's love is constant and unquestionable. The way that he shows that love is so beautiful, he can go through unimaginable lengths to prove to us that he loves us so deeply. It is also not that we loved him, but that he loved us first. We should show God's love to others because when we do so, it shows that we are the children of God. So when we ask that our eyes be open and that we can see things, it's really so we can see our Heavenly Father's love. Everybody have a great morning.
Thank you. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Almighty God, Father of love, Father of grace, Father of peace, we're so happy and thankful that we can call upon you, that we can bring all glory, honor, and praise, worship to you. The only one where worship is due is to you, Father, for you are the creator of the moment of creation, of heaven and earth. And we're so thankful that we can move in your circle, that we have been called. We have been called to a great work. And we're thankful that we can gather as a congregation, as a family, where we can, yes, struggle together, where we can cry together, where we can embrace one another, where we can serve one another, and above all things, Father, where we can prepare ourselves under your word, under your guidance for the day of your Son's return. What an amazing feeling. It wipes aside many of the concerns that we come into your house with, and you know them as well. The sorrows, the sadness, the anxiety. The times that we live in are not easy times, but you know that, Father. And when we seek you out, you will provide. You will provide that grace and that comfort and that peace that only you can provide. And it overcomes all things, all anxieties, all distresses. And so we place ourselves under you, Father, and we look up to you this morning as a united front, those that are connected, those that are present, those from the eternity realms. We look up to you this morning in awe and ask you, Father, provide even more grace and even more mercy that we can thrive in your presence. Be with those that are yet on their way traveling. We want to connect ourselves, as always this morning, to the apostolate. They are gathered in St. Louis this weekend. Father, through that apostolate, we connect ourselves to your throne of grace, because that is where we know that the truth comes, where love comes, genuine love, pure truth. Fill us now in this morning's hour with exactly what each and every one of us has need of, so that we are equipped to go out in our day-to-day lives, into our communities, and spread the gospel. All this do we bring before you, and thank you, in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning, brothers and sisters. It's nice to be together. It's nice to welcome those that are connected as well. This morning, as the foundation of our divine service, we have received a word which is written in the Acts of the Apostles, the 17th chapter, and the verses 26 and 27. And these are the words of the Apostle Paul. And he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings, so that they should seek the Lord in the hope that they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. Congregation may be seated.
Children to me gather, still today calls God's dear Son. With a look that's loving ever, and a voice that hearts as one. Come, dear children. children, come to me. Come, one and all, to me, to me. Come, dear children, come, dear children, come, one and all, to me.
Thank you. Just reflect on that for a minute. Not because Penelope sung it, because the Lord called us. Come, dear children, come to me. What comes from the soul goes to the soul. And I don't know if you feel as uplifted by that song as I do, but how beautiful is it when we know, when we come into the Lord's house, when we seek out our Heavenly Father, all He wants is come to me. He doesn't say, well, you know, here you go again with the same old mistakes, with the same old issues. Now, why don't you go in your corner for a little while and take a rest? Go to your time out. No. Our Heavenly Father, He calls us to Him. He created us to come to Him. He created us that we are drawn to Him. And you might say, yeah, but why are we still here and He's still there? Well, there's something in between called sin. And it's something that we got ourselves into trouble with, but He still created us to seek Him out. Today we close out, and that's not even a good word to close out, our month where the theme of the service is practice. I almost want to ask, are you tired yet of all this practice? We started off the month, we practice worship and wonder. Our belief in God and our how marveled we are in His creation. Then we practiced our faith through prayer and solitude. We know practice makes perfect. We're still all here, so we're not there yet. Then practice our faith, encouraging to speak, that we speak the gospel to everyone, speak the gospel to others, and that we comfort and edify one another. We practice studying scripture. Yeah, this month we had a lot of Sundays, so practice studying scripture. How are we doing? Have we looked at our report card, our little self-evaluation, and say, boy, there was a lot that was brought to us this month. There's a lot of practice that is still required. How am I doing? And today we prepare for the next Sunday for the service of the departed, and we practice seeking and responding, seeking our Heavenly Father, responding to His call. If we look at this Bible verse here in Acts, the heading of this subchapter says, to the unknown God, and it's the Apostle Paul. Now you might say, wait a minute, but the Apostle Paul knows God. There is no unknown God to the Apostle Paul because there's only one God. But it's interesting here, the Apostle Paul was on one of his many journeys, and he went through Thessalonica, and he was spreading the gospel there. And as all throughout Scripture we could read, and especially in the New Testament as well, there were troublemakers that didn't like what he heard, what they heard, what he was speaking, what he was sharing. So they chased him out of town. Actually, they wanted to do worse, but the followers, the Christians of the time, took the Apostle Paul and led him off into a different place, into Athens. So we know that the Apostle Paul was in Jerusalem. If we look a little bit at the map nowadays, we can picture Jerusalem, and then Athens is up in Greece. And so he was on a journey there, preaching the gospel. But the one thing when he was walking through Athens that threw him off a bit, there were so many idols, so many wooden, earthen, they all kinds of idols that were erected there, and altars that were erected to all these different gods. Now, if we go back a few years, I don't know about our kids if they're going through that yet, but Greek mythology, right? We learned about all the gods. There was Zeus, and there was Apollo, and so many other gods, and Scripture doesn't talk about them, but there were all kinds of altars erected to specific gods. And then the Apostle Paul saw this one God, to the unknown God, one altar addressed to the unknown God. And if we know back in the time, the Greeks, they were very curious. They were very studious. They were all about philosophy and trying to figure out life and what changes life and what impacts life, etc. So the Apostle Paul, he goes into the synagogue there. He's preaching again and sharing the thoughts then inspired by the Spirit. And he had those that attacked him again verbally, that challenged him. And so the Apostle Paul said, you know, it's interesting. And I came by an altar, and it's addressed to an unknown God. And the reason why the Greek addressed it to an unknown God is they wanted to make sure that all their base is covered. We say in local expression, they wanted to hedge their bets. Because if they left out a God, they didn't want to miss out on that God's blessings and protection, etc. So they had this altar. So the Apostle Paul went into the discourse then and shared with them, there is a God. And he came down to earth in the body of the Lord Jesus. He walked the earth and he's resurrected. And then he lost half of the congregation there because that didn't jive as well. He resurrected and returned to his heavenly Father. And so this discourse was ongoing with them. And then we can read here, and it says, and he, with a capital H, God, has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on the face of the earth. God created all human beings. And he created each and every one of us equally. No distinction. No distinction of nationality, of origin, no distinction whatsoever. All equal. Equality. In God's mind, there is equality. Mankind, well, we change sometimes our opinions. But brothers and sisters, equality. There is no better. There is no worse. If we just look at that for a minute and take that and ponder over that, out of the Lord Jesus, he brought the sacrifice for everyone. Everyone. How do you view that everyone? Everyone's treated equal. Do I treat everyone equally? Do I share my love for my fellow man equally with everyone? Do I wish for each and every one of my fellow brothers and sisters, neighbors, that they on the day that they will be able to on the day of the Lord experience his love and his grace, that they can experience salvation? Or do I have a list here on the left side that says, well, these, yeah, I kind of like these, but these on the right here, no, they don't deserve it because of what they've done in history. Our Heavenly Father doesn't care about history. The Apostle Paul says, the Lord, God created everyone for one purpose, to come back to him. Everyone without exception, to come back to him. He is the judge, the only judge. So as we look forward now to the next weekend, well, we have to be a little bit careful. Our chief apostle writes, actually in the service that he held 2 years ago on this service, he says, The undercurrent of this sermon that the Apostle Paul here held was about idolatry. And when we think about idolatry, yes, it was even described here, the altars, the statues, and all those things. But our chief apostle says, be careful. Nowadays, yes, there's the worship of money, perhaps. But he said, one of the worst idolatries that we have, one of the worst individuals that we worship, is the one that we see in the mirror. Well, I this, and I was able to do that, and I was able to master this, and it's all about me. Our chief apostle said, we have to be extremely careful. It doesn't mean that we put ourselves down, but it's all about our Heavenly Father. He chose us. He elected us. He provides for us daily. That's what we believe. We believe we're in the place where we are, in the time where we are, because He pre-appointed it that way. So then it goes on here in our Bible verse. And has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings. There, again, being mankind. Well, when things don't go our way, the first thing that we tend to do is, why? Why me? Why, Lord? Why now? Why? And there's a time to say why, to understand mathematics, to understand history, to understand certain things. But here the Apostle Paul states very clearly that he, our Heavenly Father, has already predetermined, pre-appointed the times and the places where mankind will be throughout the ages. Also a word of comfort. Now, from time to time, we'll look at the one or the other and we'll nudge each other and say, boy, he or she was born in the wrong century, right? Or, man, they're visionaries. They should have been born years from now. But the Lord also provided them for us as well to recognize the gifts and the talents that He has distributed amongst all of us. And then comes the important part, or another highlight here in the 27th verse. And again, the they is mankind, so that they should seek the Lord in the hope that they might grope Him, that they might reach for Him. Grope is maybe a word that we wouldn't associate, but grab for Him, reach for Him, and find Him. What do we seek, brothers and sisters? What is it that in our quiet moments, when we wake up, when we go to sleep, in a quiet moment during the day, what is it that we seek? I was talking to someone this morning, and in speaking, one of the things that I seek is peace. A certain level of anxiety is there because of certain things that happen in my life, so we seek peace. Or we seek friendship, or we seek financial resources, we seek something. And each of them are somewhat disconnected. Yeah, you can draw some dots. If I get finances aligned, then my anxiety for my finances, the next payment is in order, okay. But when we seek our Heavenly Father, when we seek the bridegroom of our soul, we know that grace is abundant. There is no stinginess about His grace. When we seek our Heavenly Father, when we seek Him out, we know that there is that peace, that comfort, that abundant amount of grace that we can just thrive in. And yet, sometimes, we bring other things into our boat. Not only the Lord Jesus is in our boat, man, sometimes we send Him to the back of the boat because we've got other things to do here. But brothers and sisters, we want to seek Him out because He calls us. And why does he call us? Again, it's that eternal love that he has for us. It is that love that we, there is no love that we can even compare that he has for us, no human love. We try to measure it. Well, a mother's love is so amazing. She goes through so many things just for her kids to succeed. Do we seek out that love? Do we recognize that love and that grace is abundant? We just need to turn towards it. It's not always easy. It's not always easy because the devil is very talented. The devil knows exactly what he needs to do to sow the seeds of discord, of disbelief, planting that question in our heart and soul. Not even painting the Lord bad, but just, really? You think he can? I don't know. Our chief apostle also says this seeking and this answering the Lord's call, this finding the joy in the Lord and spreading the joy, it is our responsibility as well to make sure that our neighbor feels this as well, that our neighbor feels this love, that our neighbor feels this grace, that our neighbor, yes, that our neighbor hears this call. I mean, the perfect example, the Apostle Paul, he just went, and he just told anybody who wanted to listen. But that call that we receive and that we need to make sure that that good news gets spread as well, also requires that we struggle a bit and that we overcome our own issues. That we live more in Christ and Christ lives more in us so that we can also have that brotherly and sisterly love that we extend to one another in an unlimited manner. Just as the Lord provided that for us. So our Heavenly Father, he calls us, and how do we respond? I think back my childhood. I'm looking at some of our youth and some of our kids. That's BC, that's before cell phones. You'd hear far off in the distance your mother's voice. And you knew, I knew, a certain number of blocks I could go, and then I would not hear it. And yet she would not hear that I was beyond those blocks because it doesn't matter. She calls, time to go in. Yet sometimes we said, oh, I just got to finish this inning, or I'm up at bat, or whatever. We got home a few minutes late, and well, a mother's love was always good. It's good that Dad wasn't home at that point yet. But brothers and sisters, when we receive that call, and we all have received that call, what is our first reaction? I got something to do. Just wait. Or, you know, I want to get married first. I want to find that first job. I want to buy a house first. Lord, I'm coming, but just wait. And then our chief apostle points back to this Bible verse where it says, and he has determined their pre-appointed times and boundaries of their dwelling. He said, the offer of grace is available now. We don't know if it's available when we're ready. Once we got married, once we have kids, once we find that job, once, all the things that we believe have a certain priority. How do we react? How do we respond to that call? We can look oftentimes in Scripture where there was a call. We think of Jonas, right? Call was made out. You got to do this. You got to take care of it. He's like, yeah, I got other plans. Are we a Jonas sometimes? One of our sisters here told her husband, don't be a Jonah. Brothers and sisters, we can't be Jonahs, where we all of a sudden like, well, Lord, I got something else planned right now. He's calling us. We want to respond. We want to accept the grace that he offers. We want to embrace our brother and sister. We want to embrace our neighbor. We want to spread that good news and that gospel of love and of joy and of forgiveness. Because oftentimes, those conversations are hard to have because, oh, I don't forgive myself for that. So up to there, I'm on board with you, but after that, I just can't forgive myself. We forget the Lord chose us. The Lord called us. He loves us. He knows us. In our good days and in our bad days, he knows us. And despite that, he loves us. And lastly, it says here, though he, capital H, is not far from each one of us. Again, the Apostle Paul, in his divine inspiration that he has, recognizes and preached to the Greek that our Lord and Savior came down to earth and lived with mankind. He wasn't far. He was with mankind. You might say, well, when he was up in heaven, he was so far away. So guess what? He came down to earth. The Lord became man. He walked with us. Or he walked with them. Well, then what about those in the departed realms? Well, on the day where the Lord Jesus was crucified and died, he went into paradise. He went to spend time with those who died during Noah's time. So the Lord knows our circumstances. The Lord knows the dwellings of each and every one. Why? Because he predetermined them. And so the next time when you say, or when we feel, Lord, where are you? I really need you. Well, sometimes our natural limitations block us from seeing that he's right here. He's standing right next to us. He's carrying us. He's loving us. He's smothering us with his grace. Lord, where are you? Lord, thank you for being here with me. I need you more. I need more of that grace. I need more of that love. Then we experience it. Then we can share that excitement. We can share that joy with others. We can have an impact on our neighbor so that he, she, that they can also experience the greatness of the Almighty One. Amen. Acceptance hymn. The congregation's invited. Thank you, Amanda. We'll sing together. Our Lord, our God, I think it'll be posted. We'll sing verse 1, and we'll ask our deacon to continue.
Thank you. My dearly beloved, as we heard, next Sunday is the service for the departed, but today is a chance for all of us to focus and to be reminded of what we can do in the coming week to help the souls in the realms of the departed to accept what we have come to know, that God is a God of love, to understand more about his plan of salvation, the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus, and so many things that perhaps we take for granted, that also too can be made available to souls in the realms of the departed. And let's face it, it's not so easy for these souls perhaps to learn about these things. And when you think about God, right, Priest Eprecht mentioned some of the gods from Greek or Roman mythology. Some of them were real characters, if you want to put it that way. And there are many souls in the realms of the departed. Maybe they didn't believe in God. Or who knows what they thought about God. You might say, well, God is a God of love. And it says in the text word here, it says, he's not far from each and every one of us. How about us? Do we always think that? I have to say for myself, when things are going pretty good in life, then, yeah, I think God is with me. But when stuff goes wrong or we're going through difficult times, then oftentimes we say, where are you? Why do I have to go through this? What, you know, how am I going to see my way out of this? Why me? And then we sometimes think that God is far away, God has forgotten about us, he don't exist. Who knows all the thoughts that move in our thoughts and in our heart and soul. And so souls in the realms of the departed might say, you're telling me there's a God of love? Look at my life. Look at what I had to live through. Some people say, yeah, if God is so loving, then how come this happens? Or why does God allow this or that? Everyone has different concepts or ideas, maybe, of what they think God is. How many believe in the Lord Jesus, that he's the Son of God? How many believe that when he died on the cross, that is a valid sacrifice? How many perhaps believe in the activity of the Holy Spirit or the apostle ministry? There are many people who have lived through their entire life, and they had very strong beliefs too in whatever they were taught. And now in the realms of the departed, that doesn't just change just because they are there. But now this week, we can pray and intercede for these souls. And many times I see a similarity between this work and the work in the future during the 1,000-year kingdom of peace. No, we won't be testifying directly maybe to people, but our heart's attitude towards souls. As Priest Eprecht mentioned, that there's no differentiation. That's tough to get out. That we don't hold any judgment or condemnation. That we have a pure heart. That is, we recognize that we have received grace and that we are a sinner. That we want other people to also, too, to be able to have the same grace and the same opportunity and the same chance that we do. That we want to pray and intercede for them. That we don't hold anything against anyone. That we don't look down upon people or, again, what they did in their life. But that we want them to find grace, just as we have too. And so that is up to us. And again, today is a preparation for that, but we still have a few days that between now and Sunday, but we want to do our part that we can help along in the Lord's work. Amen.
The Lord gave the apostles the responsibility. Go out, preach, baptize, and seal to all nations. And what about those that walked the earth before the apostles, before Matthew 28? What about all of them? Did they just miss out? Our chief apostle said with conviction, we know that our Heavenly Father is a fair God. We know that He will make sure that whether it is now during our lifetime, during previous lifetimes, each and every soul will have heard and will have been brought testimony. We'll have heard about the Lord Jesus. We'll have heard about this sacrifice that was brought unbeknownst to them, for them specifically, for each and every one of us. So sometimes we sit here within our human minds and thoughts thinking, well, I think I got the Lord now because He probably forgot about this, or He surely didn't think about that. The Lord's got it covered. Even for those of us who think, well, I'm just a little nobody, you are a child of God. Do not demote yourself to something that the Lord did not predestine you to be. And so now our Heavenly Father calls us to Holy Communion. Today was all about practicing our seeking and responding to the Lord. Now there's a call out there. Brother, sister, come. This is the body and the blood of the Lord Jesus given for you. How do we respond? Do we respond with, I'm not worthy of this? I need to sanctify myself first. I need to be repentant first. I need to forgive more. I need to learn to love more. The Lord knows that. So as we follow this call, brothers and sisters, let us recognize the Lord gave up His life for you, for me, so that we could be together with Him, no strings attached. Just love Him. Let's follow Him. Let's be repentant as we approach this moment. And when we do that, brother and sister, our lives will be transformed. It'll be transformed because the Lord wants it to be transformed. Because we have made a decision, a conscious decision. Yes, Lord, I want to step forward. I want to forgive. God, you know I want to forgive. Help me forgive. We have a hymn. Thank you. I invite the congregation to rise and join in the prayer which the Lord has taught us. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In the commission of our apostle, I proclaim unto you the glad tidings that in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, your sins are forgiven, and the peace of the risen one abide with you. Amen.
Amen.
Gracious, kind, loving Father, overwhelmed is not even the right way to put it. We are thankful, Father. We are joyful that we can walk with you. We are joyful and thankful that you have loved us, that you have forgiven us, that you have given us another opportunity to walk with you, that we can serve one another, that we can grow more and more into the likeness of the Lord Jesus, that we can continually practicing and experiencing your love and your grace. Father, provide for us that we will always move forward, that we will always find strength and find joy in the sacrifice which the Lord brought, the eternally valid sacrifice that has provided a space for us to live in, that has provided a future for us, that has provided an eternity together with you. Father, sanctify us now as we come forward to receive this sacrament. All this do we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And now we shall celebrate Holy Communion. And now the Lord's table is prepared. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I consecrate bread and wine for Holy Communion and lay thereupon the once brought eternally valid sacrifice of Jesus Christ. For the Lord took bread and wine, gave thanks, and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. This is my blood of the new covenant, given for many for the remission of sins. Eat and drink. Do this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this wine, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Amen.
Amen.
The body and the blood of Jesus given for you. Amen. Amen. Congregation may be seated. The Lord now invites you to come forward for Holy Communion. I invite the congregation to rise as we pray a prayer of thanksgiving. That last thought, that last emotion, Father, that has been laid into our hearts, blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. What an overwhelming sense of confidence, of assurance, of peace, but uppermost, Father, gratitude, that we can walk through life with that assurance, that we can walk through life proclaiming that assurance, sharing that assurance. We bubble over in thankfulness, Father. Thankful that we could share this moment in worship, in prayer, in thanksgiving together. And it's not just for the time of the year that we celebrate Thanksgiving, but Father, we want to be known as those that live Thanksgiving, because we know that all things come from you. We know that in all matters you are with us. And we know that as the Lord Jesus had to struggle, we too need to struggle. And the Lord Jesus was always able to rely on you, and Father, you were always there with him, and we know that the Lord is always with us. And so we go forth in the days to come, in this week ahead of us, with that blessed assurance, he is mine, he is with me. And so we thank you, Father. Thank you that we have the opportunity to also lay our offerings into the offertory, that we've been able to bring our thanksgiving to you in that shape and form. Father, bless the gift and the giver. Provide for each and every one, for the children in school, that they will do well, that they will excel, that they will always be protected through your angel service. With the youth and their plans for graduation, and the young adults in their job situations, and the families and the parents. Father, there's an abundant measure of concern, but we lay it all before you. You know what we have need of, and we thank you for that. Be with those that have special plans ahead in the days to come, plans that maybe even concern them. We bring it all before you, Father. You are the great architect. We know that in your hands we can rest assured. And now, Father, please protect us on our homeward journeys. Be with the ministers that have gathered in St. Louis today or over this week, and let them all get back to their respective homes safely. And above all things, Father, let us grow in our faith. Shorten the time for the sake of your children. Accept us all in grace. All this do we lay before you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. While we're still standing, we're invited to join in our congregational hymn, O God Beyond All Praising, verse 1 in the hymnal, verse hymn 21. Congregation, be seated. Give me 10 seconds. So all those that are connected, I just want, I know afterwards our brother's going to ask us to look into the various cameras and wave at you, but we just want to let you know we love you. We're excited that we can share this Sunday together. We love each and every one of you. And so now, announcements.
Good morning. Today we have a few announcements. Immediately after service, the children have a rehearsal in the music room upstairs, and there's a choir rehearsal at 11:15 also. And our seniors are collecting items from the congregation to send care packages to our troops. If you would like to donate, there's a full list of items needed at the Welcome Center. These items are needed by Sunday, November 12th, so make sure to get those in. A great big thank you from the Syracuse Sunday School. They were so happy and thankful for all the school supplies and donations. And I would like to everybody to say hi on the web, so we'd like to have our middle section give a nice wave and say hi. And the camera over the piano, we like to give a wave.
Are you done? You have anything else? Thank you. Great job. We've received a letter here from our apostles Schmidt, which I have been asked to read to you. Dear brothers and sisters, we continue our journey of thanksgiving, which started so wonderfully with our worship evening and district service in early October. May we all continue to praise and worship our God in our hearts and together in our community. Based on the strong impulse from this wonderful experience together, we would like to plan for another such weekend during Passiontide in 2024. Looking ahead into the new year, we will plan for a worship evening on Saturday, March 9th, and a district service on Sunday, March 10th. This can create heartfelt experiences of faith as we remember the great sacrifice of Jesus on Good Friday and prepare for the celebration of his glorious resurrection on Easter. We would like to encourage broad participation in this Passiontide event, so please mark this on your calendar. If you would like to participate, please look for the announcements along the way or email nacwoodbury@gmail.com. In all, we glorify our God in our loyal serving, loving sacrifices, and determination for unity in Christ. With special greetings, the Apostles Thomas Schmidt and Walter Schmidt. Wishing you a happy Sunday. Thank you.
Whose truck is that anyway?
I don't know, it's getting cleaned.
Whose truck is that anyway?
I don't know, it's getting cleaned.
Whose truck is that anyway?
I don't know, it's getting cleaned.
Whose truck is that anyway?
I don't know, it's getting cleaned.
Whose truck is that anyway?
I don't know, it's getting cleaned.